Good evening. Good evening and welcome to the 36th season of North Carolina's longest-running Shakespeare Festival. I'm John Russell, the Managing Director, and on behalf of the Board of Directors and the members of the Montford Park Players, we're delighted to see you all here tonight. We have a wonderful show planned for you. Before we begin, I have just a few announcements, many of which are printed in your playbill. The first is cell phones. This would be a great time to take them out, turn them to silent or vibrate, so that you don't get a call right in the middle of the performance. The next announcement concerns the restrooms. They're in the octagonal building, just as you came in. The ladies' room is on the left, gentlemen's room is on the right. There will be one 15-minute intermission, and during the intermission, our actors will be circulating through the audience with hat in hand. Our summer productions are free to the public. However, if you've enjoyed the performance, please give generously and tell your friends, because we have one more night of Dr. Faustus. Let's see, the concession stand is located at the upper center of the amphitheater, just below the control booth. We have hot coffee, hot chocolate, hot teas of all different types. We even have cold drinks. We thought it'd be chillier tonight. Aren't you glad? lots of snacks. I've been told they're all calorie-free and fat-free, but don't believe that. The concession stand accepts cash, checks, Visa, MasterCard, Discover, your firstborn, whatever. So please feel free to browse. Give you a heads up on one special event that's coming up next week. Normally this would be the end of our summer season. However, we've secured the North Carolina rights to perform the wonderful parody comedy, The Complete Works of William Shakespeare, Abridged. Starting next Wednesday through next Sunday, October 1st through the 5th, this is a fundraising show for the Montford Park Players. Will be our only ticketed show in the amphitheater. Tickets are now available online at our website, montfordparkplayers.org, and also we'll have a box office set up at the entrance to the theater on the night of each performance. So please come and see one of the funniest performances you'll ever see. It's all the Bard's 37 plays in 97 minutes, done by three actors, three of the best male actors in Asheville. And I think you'll really, really enjoy it. And let's see, what else? Oh, yes, Montford Park Players are going green. We're doing our part to help the environment, so our coffee cups at the concession stand are biodegradable and compostable. We've done away with styrofoam. Thank you. I'm glad to see that people agree. All of our light bulbs backstage, we are converting over to fluorescent tubes or compact fluorescents. And we'd like to ask you all to help us out in our endeavor by taking your recyclables tonight and placing them in one of the bins as you leave the upper last audience row as you exit. We have bins for glass, plastic bottles, aluminum cans, even a bin for cardboard and paper, including your playbills if you wanted to recycle those. If you didn't get a playbill, we have plenty up at the concession stand. So I think, one more announcement. In tonight's performance, the role of Frederick will be played by our artistic director for this performance, Jason Williams. So without further ado, we invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the Montford Park Players production of The Tragical History of Dr. Faustus.
Not marching in the fields of Thrasymene where Mars did mate the warlike Carthages, nor sporting in the dalliance of love in courts of kings where state is overturned, nor in the pomp of proud, audacious deeds intends our muse to vaunt his heavenly verse. Only this, gentles, we must now perform the form of Faustus's fortunes, good or bad. And now to patient judgments we appeal and speak for Faustus in his infancy. Now is he born of Paris, base of stock, in Germany within a town called Rhodes. At riper years to Wittenberg he went, whereas his kinsmen chiefly brought him up. So much he profits in divinity that shortly he is graced with doctor's name, excelling all and greatly can dispute in the heavenly matters of theology, till swoln with the cunning of a self-conceit. His waxen wings did mount above his reach, and melting, heavens conspired his overthrow for falling into a devilish exercise. Now glutted with learning's golden gifts, he surfeits upon accursed necromancy. For nothing so sweet as magic is to him, which he prefers before his chiefest bliss. Now this the man that in his study sits.
Settle thy studies, Faustus, and begin to plumb the depth of that thou wilt profess. Having commenced, be a divine in show, yet level at the end of every art, and live and die in Aristotle's works. Sweet analytics, 'tis thou hast ravished me. Bene disserere est finis logices, is to dispute well logic's chiefest end. Affords this art no greater miracle? Then read no more. Thou hast attained that end. A greater study fittest Faustus' wit. Bid philosophy adieu, and Galen, come. Be a physician, Faustus, heap up gold, and be eternized for some wondrous cure. Summum bonum medicinae sanitas, the end of physic is our body's health. Why, Faustus, hast thou not attained that end? Are not thy bills hung up as monuments whereby whole cities have escaped the plague, and thousand desperate maladies been cured? Yet art thou still but Faustus, and a man. Couldst thou make men to live eternally, or being dead, raise them to life again, then this profession were to be esteemed. Physic, farewell. Where is Justinian? Si una iademque res legitur duobus, a petty case of paltry legacies. Ex hereditari filium non potest pater. Oh, such is the subject of the Institute, an universal body of the law. This subject suits a mercenary drudge who dreams on nothing but external trash. Too servile and illiberal for me. When all is done, divinity is best. Jerome's Bible, Faustus. View it well. The stipendium peccati mors est. Ah, the reward of sin is death. Well, that's hard. That's si peccase negamus fallimor et nulla est in nobis veritas. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and there is no truth in us. Why then, belike, we must sin, and so consequently die. Aye, we must die an eternal death. What doctrine call you this? Que sera, sera. What will be, shall be. Divinity, adieu. These metaphysics of magicians and necromantic works are heavenly. Lines, circles, letters, characters. Aye, these are those that Faustus most desires. Oh, what a world of profit and delight, of power, of honor, and omnipotence is promised to the studious artisan. All things that move between the quiet poles shall be at my command. Emperors and kings are but obeyed in their several provinces, but his dominion that exceeds in this stretches as far as doth the mind of man. A sound magician is a demigod. Here tire my brains to win a deity. Wagner, commend me to my dearest friends, the German Balders and Cornelius. Request them earnestly to visit me. I will, sir. Their conference shall be a greater help to me than all my labors trod I ne'er so fast.
Oh, Faustus, lay that damned book aside and gaze not on it, lest it tempt thy soul and heap God's heavy wrath upon thy head. Read. Read the scriptures. That is blasphemy.
Go forward, Faustus, in that famous art, wherein all nature's treasures are contained. Be thou on earth as Jove is in the sky, master and commander of these elements.
How I am glutted with conceit of this. Shall I mix spirits, fetch me what I please, resolve me of all ambiguities, perform what desperate enterprise I will? I'll have them fly to India for gold, ransack the ocean for orient pearl, and search all corners of the newfound world for pleasant fruits and princely delicates. I'll have them read me strange philosophy and tell the secrets of all foreign kings. I'll have them wall all Germany with brass and make swift Rhine circle fair Wittenberg. I'll have them fill the public schools with silk, wherewith the students shall go bravely clad. I'll levy soldiers with the coin they bring, and chase the Prince of Parma from our land, and reign sole king of all the provinces, yea, stranger engines for the brunt of war than was the fiery keel at Antwerp Bridge. I'll make my servile spirits to invent. Come, German Faldes and Cornelius, and make me blessed with your sage conference. Faldes, sweet Faldes and Cornelius, know that your words have won me at the last to practice magic and concealed arts. And philosophy is odious and obscure. Both law and physic are for petty wits. And divinity is basest of the three, unpleasant, harsh, contemptible, and vile. 'Tis magic, magic that has ravished me. Then, gentle friends, aid me in this attempt, and I that have with subtle syllogisms graveled the pastors of the German church, and made the flowering pride of Wittenberg swarm to my problems as the infernal spirits on sweet Musaeus when he came to hell, will be as cunning as Agrippa was, whose shadows made all Europe honor him.
Faustus, these books, thy wit, and our experience shall make all nations to canonize us. As Indian Moors obey their Spanish lords, so shall the spirits of every element be always serviceable to us three. Like lions shall they guard us when we please, like all-made rudders and their horsemen staves, or Lapland giants trotting by our sides, sometimes like women or unwed maids, shadowing more beauty in their airy brows than have the white breasts of the Queen of Love. From Venice shall they drag huge argosies, and from America the golden fleece that yearly stuffs old Philip's treasury, if learned Faustus will be resolute.
Valdes, I am as resolute in this as thou to live, therefore object it not.
The miracles that magic will perform will make thee bound to study nothing else. He that is grounded in astrology, enriched with tongues, well seen in minerals, hath all the principles that magic doth require. Then doubt not, Faustus, but to be renowned, and more frequented for this mystery than heretofore the Delphian oracle. The spirits tell me they can dry the sea and fetch the treasure of all foreign wrecks, yea, all the wealth that our forefathers hid within the massy entrail to the earth. And tell me, Faustus, what shall we three want?
Nothing, Cornelius. Oh, this cheers my soul. Come, show me some demonstrations magical that I may conjure in some bushy grove and have these joys in full possession.
Then haste thee to some solitary grove and bear wise Bacon's and Albertus' works, the Hebrew Psalter and New Testament, and whatever else shall be requisite. We will inform thee ere our conference cease.
Valdes first, let him know the words of art. Then, all other ceremonies learned, Faustus may try his cunning by himself.
First, I'll instruct thee in the rudiments, and then wilt thou be perfecter than I.
Then come and dine with me, and after meat we'll canvass every quiddity thereof. For ere I sleep, I'll try what I can do. This night I'll conjure, though I die therefore.
I wonder what's become of Faustus. That was wont to make our schools ring with sick provo.
That shall we presently know. Here comes his boy.
How now, sirrah? Where's thy master?
God in heaven knows.
Why, dost not thou know, then?
Yes, I know, but that follows not.
Go to, sirrah, leave your jesting and tell us where he is.
That follows not by force of argument, which you, being licentiate, should stand upon. Therefore, acknowledge your error and be attentive.
Then you will not tell us.
You are deceived, for I will tell you. But if you were not dunces, you would never ask me such a question. For is he not corpus naturale? And is not that mobile? Wherefore then do you ask me such a question? But that I am by nature phlegmatic, slow to wrath, and prone to lechery, to love, I would say. It were not for you to come within 40 foot of the place of execution, though I do not but doubt to see you both hanged come the next sessions. Thus, having triumphed over you, I will set my countenance like a precisian and begin to speak thus. Surely, my dear friend, my master is within, at dinner, with Valdes and Cornelius. As this wine, if it could speak, would inform your worship. And so, the Lord bless you, and preserve you, and keep you, my dear brethren.
Oh, Faustus, then I fear that which I have long suspected, that thou art fallen into that damned art, for which they too are infamous through the world.
Were he a stranger, not allied to me, the danger of his soul would make me mourn. But come, let us go and inform the rector. It may be his grave counsel may reclaim him.
I fear me nothing will reclaim him now.
Yet let us see what we can do.
Now that the gloomy shadow of the night, longing to view Orion's drizzling look, leaps from the Antarctic world unto the sky and dims the welkin with her pitchy breath, Faustus, begin thine incantations and see if devils will obey thy hest, seeing thou hast prayed and sacrificed to them. Within this circle is Jehovah's name, forward and backward anagrammatized. The abbreviated names of holy saints, figures of every adjunct to the heavens, and characters and signs of wandering stars by which the spirits are enforced to rise. Then fear not, Faustus, to be resolute, and try the utmost magic can perform. Sint mi Dei Acherontis propitii, valiat nomen triplex Jehovah. Ignii arii Aquitani Spiritus Salvete, Orientis Princeps Beelzebub, Inferni Ardentis Monarca, et Demogorgon propitiamus vos, ut aperiat et surgat Mephistopheles! Quid tu moraris per Jehovam Gehenam et consecratam aquam quam nunc spargo? Signumque crucis quod nunc facio, et per vota nostris ipsilonc nobis surgat Mephistopheles! thee to return and change thy shape. Thou art too ugly to attend on me. Go and return an old Franciscan friar. That holy shape becomes a devil best. I see there's virtue in my heavenly words. Who would not be proficient in this art? How pliant is this Mephistopheles, full of obedience and humility. Such is the force of magic and my spells.
Now, Faustus, what wouldst thou have me do?
I charge thee wait upon me whilst I live, to do whatever Faustus shall command, be it to make the moon drop from her sphere, or the ocean overwhelm the world.
I am a servant of great Lucifer. I may not follow thee without his leave. No more than he commands must we perform.
Did not he charge thee to appear to me?
No. I came hither of my own accord.
Did not my conjuring speeches raise thee? Speak.
Oh, that was the cause, but yet peroxidens. For when we hear one rack the name of God, abjure the scriptures and his Savior Christ, we fly in hope to get his glorious soul. Nor will we come unless he use such mean means by which he is likely to be damned. Therefore, the shortest cut to conjuring is stoutly to abjure all godliness and to pray devoutly to the Prince of Hell.
So Faustus hath already done and holds this principle. There is no chief but only Beelzebub, to whom Faustus doth dedicate himself. This word, damnation, terrifies not me, for I confound hell in Elysium. My ghost be with the old philosophers. But leaving these vain trifles of men's souls, come, tell me, what is that Lucifer thy lord?
Arch-regent and captain of all spirits.
Was not that Lucifer an angel once?
Aye, Faustus. And most dearly loved of God.
How comes it then that he is prince of devils?
Oh, for aspiring pride and insolence, for which God threw him from the face of heaven.
And what are you that live with Lucifer?
Unhappy spirits that fell with Lucifer, conspired against our God with Lucifer, and are forever damned with Lucifer.
Where art thou damned?
In hell.
How comes it then that thou art out of hell?
Why, this is hell. Nor am I out of it. Think'st thou that I, who saw the face of God and tasted the eternal joys of heaven, am not tormented with 10,000 hells for being deprived of heavenly bliss? Oh, Faustus, leave these frivolous demands that strike a terror in my fainting soul.
What is great Mephistopheles so passionate for being deprived of the joys of heaven? Learn thou of Faustus manly fortitude and scorn those joys thou never shall possess. Go, bear these tidings to great Lucifer. Seeing that Faustus hath incurred eternal death by desperate plots against Jove's deity, say he surrenders to him up his soul, so that he spare him 24 years, letting him live in all voluptuousness, having thee ever to attend on me, to give me whatsoever I shall ask, to tell me whatsoever I demand, to slay mine enemies and to aid my friends, and always be obedient to my will. Go and return to mighty Lucifer, and meet me in my study at midnight, and there resolve me of thy master's mind.
Faustus, I will.
Had I as many souls as there be stars, I'd give them all for Mephistopheles. By him I'll be great emperor of the world, and make a bridge through the moving air to pass the ocean with a band of men. I'll join the hills that bind the Afric shore and make that country continent to Spain and both contributory to my crown. The emperor shall not live but by my leave, nor any potentate of Germany. Now I have obtained what I desire. I'll live in speculation of this art till Mephistopheles return again.
Thank you.
hither, sirrah boy.
Boy! Oh, disgrace to my person! Boy! Zounds! Oh, boy, in your face! You have seen many boys with beards, I am sure.
Well, sirrah, hast thou no comings in?
Aye, sir, and goings out too, you may see.
Alas, poor slave! Thou seest how poverty jests in his nakedness. I know he is out of service, and so hungry that I know he would give his soul to the devil for a shoulder of mutton, though it were blood raw.
How? My soul to the devil for a shoulder of mutton, though it were blood raw?
Aye.
Not so, good friend. By your lady, I had need to have it well roasted and good sauce to it, if I pay so dear, I can tell you.
Wilt thou be my man, sirrah, and wait upon me, and I will make thee go, qui mihi discipulus.
What? In verse?
No, slave, in beaten silk and staves acre.
Staves acre? That's good to kill vermin. Then belike, if I serve you, I shall be lousy.
So thou shalt be, whether thou dost it or no. For if thou dost not presently bind thyself to me for 7 years, I'll turn all the lice about thee into familiars and have them tear thee in pieces.
Aye, sir, you may save yourself a labor, for they're as familiar with me as if they paid for their meat and drink, I can tell you.
Well, sirrah, leave off thy jesting and take these guilders.
Aye, good sir, and I thank you. Oh, and what should I do with these?
Why, now, sirrah, thou art to be at an hour's warning, whensoever and wheresoever the devil shall fetch thee.
Take your guilders, then! I'll none of them!
No, not I. Thou art pressed. Prepare thyself, or I shall presently summon up two devils to carry thee away. Belial! Belcher!
Let your Belial Belcher come here and I'll knock them! Ooh, they were never so knocked since they were devils! Say, what if I should kill one of them? What would folks say? See ye yonder tall fellow in the round slop? He has killed the devil! Oh, then I shall be called Kill Devil all the parish over!
How now, sirrah? Wilt thou serve me now?
Aye, sir. Take the devils away, then.
Spirits, away. Away! Well, sirrah, follow me.
Oh, but do you hear, good Wagner? If I follow you, will you teach me to raise up Balios and Belchios?
Aye, I'll teach thee to turn thyself into a dog or a cat or a mouse or a rat or anything.
How? A Christian follow into a dog, a cat, a mouse, or a rat? No, no, sir. If you should turn me into anything, let it be into a little pretty frisking flea. Oh, that I may be here, oh, and there, and everywhere. Oh, I'll tickle the pretty wench's plackets, I will. I'll be amongst them in faith.
Oh, well, sirrah, follow me.
Oh, but do you hear, good Wagner?
Ah! Balliol and Belcher!
I pray thee, let Balliol and Belcher go sleep.
Villain, call me Master Wagner, and see that thou walkest attentively, letting thy right eye be always diametrically affixed upon my left heel, so that thou mayest quasi vestigius nostre insistere.
Oh, God, forgive me. He speaks Dutch fustian. Well, I'll follow him. I'll serve him, that's flat.
Now, Faustus, must thou needs be damned? Canst thou not be saved? What boots it then to think on God or heaven? Away with such vain of fancies and despair. Despair in God and trust in Beelzebub. Now, go not backward, Faustus. Be resolute. Why waverest thou? Oh, something soundeth in mine ear. Abjure this magic. Turn to God again. Why he loves thee not. The God thou servest is thine own appetite, wherein is fixed the love of Beelzebub. To him I'll build an altar and a church, and offer lukewarm blood of newborn babes.
Oh, go forward, Faustus, in that famous art.
Sweet Faustus, leave that execrable art.
Contrition, prayer, repentance, what of these?
Oh, they are means to bring thee unto heaven.
Rather illusions, Faustus, fruits of lunacy, that make men foolish that do use them most.
Sweet Faustus, think of heaven and of heavenly things.
No, Faustus, think of honor and wealth.
Wealth? Why, the scenery of Emden shall be mine. When Mephistopheles shall stand by me, what power can hurt me? Faustus, thou art safe. Cast no more doubt. Away thee, away thee, Mephistopheles. Come, Mephistopheles, and bring great tidings from great Lucifer. It is not midnight. Come, Mephistopheles, and bring glad tidings from great Lucifer. Is not midnight. Come, Mephistopheles. Veni, veni, Mephistopheles. Now tell me, what saith Lucifer, thy lord?
That I should wait on Faustus while he lives, so he should buy my service with his soul.
And already Faustus hath hazarded that for thee.
But now thou must bequeath it solemnly, and write a deed of gift with thine own blood. Such security craves Lucifer. If thou deniest it, I must back to hell.
Nay, stay, Mephistopheles, and tell me, what good will my soul do thy lord?
Enlarge his kingdom.
Is that the reason why he tempts us thus?
Misery loves company.
Why, have you any pain that torture others?
As great as have the human souls of men. Oh, but tell me, Faustus, shall I have thy soul? I'll wait on thee and give thee more than thou hadst wit to ask.
I'm Mephistopheles. I'll give it thee.
Then stab thy arm courageously and bind my soul, that at some certain day great Lucifer may claim it as his own, then be thou as great as Lucifer.
Lo, Mephistopheles, for love of thee, Faustus hath cut his arm, and with his proper blood assures his soul to be great Lucifer's chief regent and lord of perpetual night.
But write it, Faustus, in manner of a deed of gift.
Aye, so do I. But Mephistopheles, my blood congeals, and I can write no more.
I'll bring thee fire to dissolve it straight.
What should the staying of my blood portend? Is it unwilling I should write this bill? Why streams it not that I may write afresh? Faustus gives to thee his soul. There it stayed. Why shouldst thou not? Is thy soul not thine own? Then write anew. Faustus gives to thee his soul.
I hear his fire, Faustus. Set it on.
So, now the blood begins to clear again. Now will I make an end immediately.
What will I not do to gain his soul?
Consummatum est. This bill is ended. And Faustus hath bequeathed his soul to Lucifer. But what is this inscription on my arm? Homo fuge.
Whither should I fly if unto God he'll throw me down to hell? My senses are deceived. Here's nothing rich. Oh, yes. I see it plain. Even here is writ, homo fuge. Yet shall not Faustus fly.
I'll fetch him somewhat to delight his mind.
What means this show? Speak, Mephistopheles.
Why, nothing, Faustus, but to delight thy mind and let thee see what magic can perform.
May I raise such spirits when I please?
Oh, yes, Faustus, and do greater things than these.
Then Mephistopheles received this scroll, a deed of gift of body and of soul, but yet conditionally that thou perform all covenants and articles between us both.
I swear by hell and Lucifer to effect all covenants between us both.
Then hear me read it, Mephistopheles. On the conditions following, that Faustus may be a spirit in form and substance. Second, that Mephistopheles shall be his servant and be by him commanded. Thirdly, that Mephistopheles shall do for him and bring him whatsoever he desire. Fourth, that he shall be in his chamber or house invisible. Lastly, that he shall appear to the said John Faustus at all times in whatsoever shape or form he pleases. And I, John Faustus of Wittenberg, doctor, by these presents do give both body and soul to Lucifer, prince of the East, and to Mephistopheles, his minister. And furthermore, to grant unto them 24 years, being expired, and the above written articles inviolate, a full power to fetch or carry the said John Faustus, body and soul, flesh and blood, into their habitation, wheresoever, by me, John Faustus.
Speak, Faustus. Do you deliver this as your deed?
I take it, and the devil give thee good of it.
Now, Faustus, ask what thou wilt.
First will I question with thee about hell. Tell me, where is the place that men call hell?
Why, under the heavens.
Aye, and so are all things else. But whereabouts?
Within the body of these elements where we are tormented and remain forever. Hell hath no limits, nor is circumscribed in one self place. Where we are is hell, and where hell is, there must we forever be. And to be short, when the world dissolves and every creature shall be purified, all places shall be hell that are not heaven.
I think hell's a fable.
Well, think so until experience change thy mind.
What? Dost thou think that Faustus shall be damned?
Of a necessity. For here is the scroll wherein thou givest thy soul to Lucifer.
Aye, and body too, but what of that? Think'st thou that Faustus is so fond to imagine that after this life there is any pain? No, these are trifles, mere old wives' tales.
But I am an example to the contrary, for I tell thee that I am damned and now in hell.
If this be hell, I'll willingly be damned. What sleeping, eating, walking, disputing, believing this? Let me have a wife, the fairest maid in Germany, for I am a wanton and lascivious and cannot live without a wife.
Well, Faustus, thou shalt have a wife.
What sight is this?
Now, Faustus, wilt thou have a wife?
Here's a hot whore indeed. No, I'll have no wife.
Marriage is but a ceremonial toy. If thou lovest me, speak no more of it. I'll call thee out the fairest courtesans and bring them every morning to your bed. What thy eye shall like, thy heart shall shall have, be she as chaste as Penelope, as wise as Saba, or as beautiful as was bright Lucifer before the fall. Here, take this book. Peruse it well. The iterating of these words brings gold. The framing of this circle on the ground brings thunder, whirlwind, storm, and lightning. Say these words devoutly 3 times to thyself, and men in harness will appear to thee, ready to execute whatever thou commandest.
Thanks, Mephistopheles. Yet, fain would I have a book wherein I might observe all spells and incantations that I may raise up spirits when I please.
They are here too. See.
Now would I have a book wherein I may see all the signs and planets of the heavens, that I may know their motions and dispositions.
Here they are.
Nay, let me have one book more, and then I have done, wherein I may see all plants, herbs, and trees that grow upon the earth.
Will you see, Faustus? Here it is.
Thou art deceived.
Nay, I warrant you.
When I behold the heavens, then I repent and curse thee, wicked Mephistopheles, because thou hast deprived me of those joys.
'Twas thine own seeking, Faustus. Thank thyself. But dost thou think the heaven is so glorious? I tell thee, Faustus, that it is not half so glorious as thee or any other man that breathes on earth.
How proves thou that?
'Twas made for man, then he's more excellent.
If heaven was made for man, 'twas made for me. I will renounce this magic and repent.
Faustus, repent! Yet God will pity thee.
Thou art a spirit, Faustus. God cannot pity thee.
Who buzzes in mine ear? I am a spirit. Be I a devil, God may pity me. Yea, God will pity me if I repent.
Aye. But Faustus shall never repent.
My heart is hardened. I cannot repent. Scarce can I name salvation, faith, or heaven. Swords, poisons, halters, and envenomed steel are laid before me to dispatch myself. And long ere this I should have done the deed, had not sweet pleasure conquered the deep despair. Have I not made blind Homer sing to me of Alexander's love and Enon's death? And hath not he that built the walls of Thebes with rapturous sound of his melodious harp made music with my Mephistopheles? Why should I die then, or basely despair? I am resolved, Faustus shall not repent. Come, Mephistopheles, let us dispute again, and reason of divine astrology. Speak, are there many spheres above the moon? Are all celestial bodies but one globe, as is the substance of this centric earth?
As are the elements, even such are the spheres, even from the sphere of the moon unto the imperial orb, mutually folded in each other's spheres, and jointly move upon one axle tree, whose termines term the world's wide pole. Nor are the names Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, feigned but are erring stars.
But have they all one motion, both in situ and temporary?
All move from east to west in 24 hours upon the poles of the earth, but differ in their motion upon the poles of the zodiac.
These slender questions Wagner can decide. Hath Mephistopheles no greater skill? Who knows not the double motion of the planets, that the first is finished in a natural day, the second thus? Saturn in 30 years, Jupiter in 12, Mars in 4, a sun, Mercury, and Venus in a year, the moon in 28 days. Why, these are freshmen's questions. But answer me this. Have they all a dominion or a intelligentsia? How many planets or heavens are there?
9. The 7 planets, the firmament, and the imperial heaven.
That is, they're not caelum igneum et crystallinum.
Oh no, Faustus, those be but fables.
Now resolve me this one question. Why are there not oppositions, eclipses, adjuncts, conjunctions, all at one time, but in some years we have more and some less?
Per inoviqualum, motum respectu totius.
Yeah, well, I am answered. And now tell me this. Who made the world?
Faustus, I will not.
Sweet Mephistopheles, tell me.
Tempt me not, Faustus.
Villain, have I not bound thee to tell me anything?
Anything that is not against our kingdom? This is. Thou art damned. Think thou on hell.
You think, Faustus, upon God that made the world.
Remember this.
I go, accursed spirit, to ugly hell. 'Tis thou has damned distressed Faustus' soul. Is not too late?
Too late.
Never too late. If Faustus will repent.
Faustus! If thou repent, devils will tear thee to pieces.
Repent, and they shall never raise thy skin.
Oh, Christ, my Savior,
no!
Seek to save distressed Faustus' soul. Christ cannot save thy soul.
For he is just. There's none save I has interest in the same.
Oh, what art thou that looks so fairly?
I am Lucifer, and this is my companion, Prince in Hell.
Oh, Faustus, they are come to fetch thy soul.
We have come to tell thee thou dost injure us.
Thou callest on Christ, contrary to thy promise.
Thou shouldst not think on God.
Think of the devil.
And his dam, too.
Oh, pardon him for this, and Faustus vows never to look to heaven.
So shall thee show thyself an obedient servant, and we will highly gratify thee for it.
Faustus, we have come from hell, in person, to show thee some pastime. Sit down, and thou shalt behold the 7 deadly sins appear to thee in their proper shapes and likeness.
That sight shall be as pleasant unto me as a paradise was to Adam on the first day of his creation.
Speak not of paradise or creation, but mark the show. Go, Mephistopheles, fetch them in. Now, Faustus, question these as to their names and disposition.
And that shall I do soon. Now, what art thou the first?
I am pride. I disdain to have any parents. I am like to Ovid's flea. I can creep into every corner of a wench. Sometimes, like a periwig, I sit upon her brow. Next, like a necklace, I hang about her neck. Then, like a fan of feathers, I kiss her lips. And then, turning myself to a rock smock, to what I list. But fire, what smell is here? I will not speak a word more for a king's ransom, unless the ground be perfumed and covered with cloth of arras.
Thou art a proud knave indeed. What art thou the second?
I am covetousness, begotten of an old churl in a leather bag. And might I now obtain my wish? This house, you, and all might be turned to gold, so that I might lock you and safe into my chest. Oh, my sweet gold!
What art thou third?
I am envy, begotten of a chimney sweeper and an oyster wife. I cannot read. And therefore wish all books burned. I am lean with seeing others eat. Oh, that there would come a famine over all the world, that all might die and I live. how fat I'd be. But must thou sit and I stand? Come down with a vengeance!
Thou envious wretch! What art thou before?
I am wrath! I had neither father nor mother! I leapt out of a lion's mouth and I was scarce an hour old! And ever since, have to run up and down this world with these cases of rapiers, wounding myself when I could find none to fight withal! I was born in hell, and look to it, for some of you shall be my father!
What art thou, little
bit? I am gluttony! My parents are all dead, and the devil a penny they have left me, but a small pension that buys me 30 meals a day and 10 bevers. A small trifle to suffice nature. My father was a gammon of bacon. My mother, a hogshead of claret wine. My forefathers were these: Peter Pickled Herring and Martin Marshalmas Beef. And my godmother, oh, she was an ancient gentlewoman, well-loved in every good city and town. And her name? Marjorie Marshbeer. Now, Faustus, thou hast heard my progeny. Wilt thou bid me to suffer?
No, I'll see thee hanged, and thou art eat all thy pickles.
Then the devil choke thee!
And choke thyself, glutton. What art thou, but sick?
I am sloth. I was begotten on a sandy bank, where I've lain ever since, and you have done me great injury to bring me from thence. Let me be carried thither again by gluttony and lechery. Hey-ho! I'll not speak a word more for a king's ransom.
And what are you, Mistress Minx, the seventh and last?
Who, I, sir? I am one who loves an inch of raw mutton better than an L of fried stockfish. And the first letter of my name is L.
Away, to hell, away, on Piper.
How this sight doth delight my soul.
Oh, touch, Faustus. In hell is all manner of delight.
Oh, might I see hell and return again safe, how happy were I then.
So shall thee soon. At midnight I will fetch for thee. Meanwhile, take this book, peruse its contents and read it thoroughly, and thou wilt turn thyself into whatever shape thou wilt.
Thanks, mighty Lucifer. This shall I keep as cherry as my life.
Now, Faustus, farewell.
Farewell, great Lucifer. Come, Mephistopheles.
What, Ralph? Look to the horses there till I come again.
Ah, this is admirable. Here have I stolen one of Dr. Faustus's conjuring books. And if faith, I mean to search some circles for my own use. Now will I make all the maids of the parish dance at my pleasure, stark naked before me. And by that means I shall see more than I saw or felt yet.
Robin, prithee, come away. There's a gentleman tarries to have his horse, and he would have his things rubbed and made clean. He keeps such a chanting with my mistress about it, and she has sent me to look thee out. Prithee, come away.
Keep out, lest you're blown up, you're dismembered, Ralph. Keep out, for I'm about a roaring piece of work.
Oh, snails, what hast thou got there? A book? Why, thou canst not tell ne'er a word on it.
That thou shalt see presently. Keep out of the circle, I say, lest I send you into the ostry with a vengeance.
That's like faith. You had best leave your foolery, and my master come, he'll conjure you. Faith.
My master, conjure me.
Yeah.
I'll tell thee what, my master, come here. I'll clap his fair pair of horns on his head, as ere thou sawest to thy life.
Well, thou needst not do that, for my mistress hath done it.
There be those of us have waded as deep into those matters as other men, if they were disposed to talk.
A plague take you! I thought you did not sneak up and down after her for nothing. But I prithee, tell me in good sadness, what book is that?
What book?
Yeah.
Why, the most intolerable book for conjuring that e'er was invented by any brimstone devil.
Canst thou conjure with it?
I can do all these things with it. First, I can make thee drunk with hypocrisy at any tavern in Europe. That's one of my conjurings.
Our Master Parson says that's nothing.
I do but say what thou have me do, and I'll do it.
Okay.
If thou dance naked, then put off thy clothes, and I'll conjure thee about presently.
Yeah.
And more, Ralph, if thou hast any mind to man-spit our kitchen maid, then take her and wind her to thy own use as often as thou wilt, and at midnight. And if you go with me to the tavern, I'll give thee white wine, red wine, claret wine, sack, muscadine, malmsey, whipping crust, a whole belly hold, and we'll pay not one penny for it.
Ah, brave! On that condition, I'll feed thy devil with horse bread as long as he lives. A free cost. Prithee, let's to it presently, for I am as dry as a dog.
No more, sweet Ralph. Let us make clean our boots and thy fowl in our hands, and then to our conjuring in the devil's name.
Learned Faustus, to find the secrets of astronomy graven in the book of Jove's high firmament, did mount him up the scale Olympus's top, where sitting in a chariot burning bright, drawn by the strength of yoked dragons' necks, he views the clouds, the planets and the stars, the tropic zones and corners of the sky, from the circle of the bright horned moon even to the height of Primo Mobile, and whirling round with this circumference within the concave compass of the pole, from east to west his dragons swiftly glide, and in 8 days did bring him home again. Not long he stayed within his quiet house to rest his bones weary from his toil, but new exploits do hail him out again, and mounted then upon a dragon's back, that with his wings did part the subtle air, he is now gone to prove cosmography, which studies coasts and kingdoms of the earth. And as I guess, will first arrive at Rome to see the Pope and view the manner of his court, and take some part in Holy Peter's feast, the which this day is highly solemnized.
Now tell me, gentle Mephistopheles, what resting place is this? Hast thou, as erst I did command, conducted me within the walls of Rome?
Aye, my Faustus. And for proof thereof, here is the goodly palace of the Pope. And because we are no ordinary guest, I choose for our use his privy chamber.
I hope his holiness will bid us welcome.
All's one. We'll make bold with his venison. But I think you fain would see this Pope and take some part in Holy Peter's feast.
Sweet Mephistopheles, thou pleasest me. Whilst I am here on earth, let me be cloyed with all things that delight the heart of men. My 24 years of liberty I'll spend in pleasure and in dalliance. Let Faustus' name, while this bright frame shall stand, may be admired thorough the furthest land.
Ah, well said my Mephistopheles, well said my Faustus. Now, come stand by me, and thou shalt see them come immediately.
Then in this show let me an actor be, that this proud Pope may Faustus' cunning see.
Be it as you wish. Now, Faustus, devise what best contents thy mind and cunning of thy art to cross this Pope and dash the pride of his solemnity and make his monks and abbots stand like apes or point like antics in his triple crown or beat the beads about the friar's pates, or clap huge horns upon the cardinal's heads. Whatever villainy thou devise, I will perform it. This day will make you admire.
tired and robed.
Well, I am content to compass then some sport, but now that Faustus may delight his mind and by their foolishness make some merriment, sweet Mephistopheles so charm me now that I may walk invisible to all and do whate'er I please, unseen of envy.
Be thou so, my Faustus. Now, kneel down presently, and on thy head I'll lay my hand and charm thee so that thou shalt appear invisible to all those here. By the seven planets, the gloomy air, hell and the Furies' forked hair, Pluto's blue fire and Hecate's tree, with magic spells so compass thee that no eye may thy body see. Now, for all their holiness, if thou wilt, thou shalt not be discerned.
Thanks, Mephistopheles. Now, friars, take heed, lest Faustus make thy shaven crowns to bleed.
Lord Archbishop of Reims, sit down with us.
I thank your holiness.
Fall to, and the devil choke you, and you spare.
How now? Who's that which spake? Friars, look about!
Here's nobody, if it please your holiness.
My good Lord Archbishop, here's a dainty dish which sent me the Bishop of Milan.
I thank you, sir.
How now? Who snatched the meat from me? Villains! Why speak you not? My lord, here's a dainty dish which sent me a cardinal in France.
I'll have that too.
What? Lollards, to attend our holiness, that we do receive such great indignity. Fetch me some wine.
I pray too, for Faustus is a dry.
My good lord Archbishop, I drink unto your grace.
I pledge your grace.
My wine gone too! Ye lubbers, look about, and find the man that doth this villainy. Oh, by our sanctitude, you all shall die! I pray, my lord, have patience at this troublesome banquet.
Please it, your holiness. I think it may be a ghost that crept out of purgatory, and had come unto your holiness for his pardon.
It may be so. Go then, command our priest to sing a dirge, to lay the fury of this same troublesome ghost.
What must every bit be spiced with a cross? Nay, then, take that! Use not that trick again. I do advise you. I give you fair warning.
I am slain! Oh, help me, my lord! Oh, come and help to bear my body hence! Damned be his soul forever for this deed!
Now, Faustus, what wilt thou do? For I think thou shalt be damned by bell, book, and candle.
Oh, a bell, book, and candle. Candle, book, and bell. Forward and backward to curse Faustus to hell.
Come, brethren, let's about our business with good devotion.
Cursed be he that stole his holiness' meat from the table, maledicat Dominus. Cursed be he that struck his holiness a blow on the face, maledicat Dominus. Cursed be he that struck Friar Sandello a blow on the page, maledicat Dominus. Cursed be he that struck his holiness a blow on the
I'm not scared of dying and I don't really care if it's cheapifying and dying. Well, then let the time
come, Ralph!
Did I not tell you we were forever made by this Dr. Faustus's book, aka Signum? Here's a simple purchase for horse keepers. The horses will eat no hay as long as this lasts.
Sirrah Robin, we were best looked that your double can answer the stealing of this same cup, for the vintner's boy follows us at the hard hill.
That is no matter, let him come. And he follow us, I'll so conjure him, as he was ne'er conjured in his life, I'll warrant him. Let me see the cup.
Here it is. Yonder he comes. Now, Robin, now or never, show thy cunning.
Oh, are you here? I'm glad I have found you. A fine pair of companions you make. Pray, where is the cup you stole from the tavern?
How? We steal a cup? Take heed what you say. We look not like cup stealers, I can tell you.
Never deny it, for I know you have it, and I will search you.
Search me, I am spare not. Hold the cup, Ralph. Come, search me. Search me.
Come on, Sirrah. Let me search you now.
Aye, do. Hold the cup, Robin. I fear not your searching. We scorn to steal your cups, I can tell you. What?
Never outface me for the matter, for sure. The cup is between you two.
Nay, there you lie. 'Tis beyond us both.
A plague take you. I thought 'twas your neighbor to take it away. Come, give it to me again.
Aye, well, when can you tell? Make me a circle, Ralph. Stand close at my back. Stir not for thy life.
Sanctobulorum peritrasticonde, I'll tickle you, vintner. Look to the goblet, Ralph. Say nothing, Ralph. Polypragmos. Belcevorum, patostivos tosto framanto. Belcher and Mephistopheles.
Oh, you princely legions of infernal rule, how am I vexed with these villains' charms? From Constantinople they have brought me here only for pleasure of these damned slaves.
My lady, sir, you've made a shrewd journey of it. Will it please you to take a shoulder of mutton into supper? And a tester in your purse! And go back again?
I pray you heartily, sir, for we called you but in jest, I promise you.
To purge the rashness of this cursed deed, first be turned into this ugly shape, for impish deeds transformed to an ape!
How? Into an ape? That's brave. I'll have fine sport with the boys. I'll get nuts and apples in now. Whoa.
And so thou shalt. And you transform into a dog.
A dog?
Away. Be gone.
Oh, I had to wear me out of the potty pot. Okay, Robin. So you go there. I'll go this way. I'll just see you later, okay?
And now, with flames of ever-burning fire, I'll wing myself and forthwith fly amain unto my Faustus at the German court. Be gone, Robin.
Magic art. He intends to show Great Careless the race of all his top progenitors and bring in presence of his majesty the perfect shapes of Alexander and his beauteous paramour. Go back and see the state in readiness.
Where's Benvolio?
Fast asleep, I warrant you. He took his rouse with stoups of Rhenish wine so kindly yesternight to Bruno's help that all this day the sluggard keeps his bed.
See, his window's open. We'll call to him.
What ho, Benvolio!
What a devil ail you two?
Speak softly, sir, lest the devil hear you. For Faustus at the court is late arrived, and at his heels a thousand furies wait to accomplish whatsoever the doctor pleases.
What of this?
Come, leave thy chamber first, and thou shalt see such rare exploits as never yet was seen in Germany.
Come, wilt thou come down and see the sport?
Not I.
Wilt thou stand in thy window and see it then?
Aye, and I not fall asleep in the meantime.
The Emperor is at hand, who comes to see what wonders by black spells may compass to be.
Well, go you attend the Emperor then. I am content for this once to thrust my head out of the window. For they say, if a man be drunk overnight, the devil cannot harm him in the morning. If that be true, I have such a charm in my head shall control both him and the conjurer, I warrant you.
Wonder of men, renowned magician, thrice learned Faustus, welcome to our court. Master Dr. Faustus, I have heard strange report of thy knowledge in the black art. How that none in my empire, nor the whole world, can compare with thee for the rare effects of magic. They say thou hast a familiar spirit by whom thou canst accomplish what thou list. This, therefore, is my request, that thou let me see some sign of thy knowledge, that mine eyes may be witnesses to confirm what mine ears have heard reported. Oh, and here I swear to thee, by the honor of my imperial crown, that whatever thou doest, thou shalt be not prejudiced nor in damage.
These gracious words, most royal Carolus, shall make poor Faustus to his utmost power both love and serve the German emperor. For proof whereof, if so your grace be pleased, the doctor stands prepared, by power of art, to cast his magic charms, which shall pierce through the ebon gates of ever-burning hell, and hail the stubborn furies from their caves, to compass whatsoe'er your grace command.
Bloody speaks terribly. And for all this, I do not greatly believe him. He looks to a conjurer like the Pope to a costermonger.
Then, Dr. Faustus, hear what I shall say, as I was sometimes solitary set within my cabinet, sundry thoughts arose about the honor of mine ancestors, how they had won by prowess such exploits, got such riches, subdued so many kingdoms, as we that do succeed, or they that shall hereafter possess our throne, shall I fear me ne'er attain to that degree of high renown and great authority, amongst which kings is Alexander the Great, chief spectacle of the world's preeminence, the bright shining of whose glorious acts lightens the world with his reflecting beams. As when I hear but mention made of him, it grieves my soul. I never saw the man. If thou by cunning of thine art canst raise this man from hollow vaults below where lies entombed this famous conqueror, and bring with him his beauteous paramour, both in their right shapes, gesture, and attire they used to wear, thou shalt both satisfy my just desire and give me cause to praise thee whilst I live.
Your Majesty shall see them presently. Go, Mephistopheles, and bring before this royal emperor the great Alexander and his beauteous paramour.
Faustus, I will.
Well, Master Doctor, and your devil's gonna come away quickly. I shall be asleep presently. Zounds, I can eat myself with anger that I have been an ass all this while to stand gaping after the devil's governor and can see nothing.
I'll make you feel something anon, if my art fail me not. My gracious lord, I must forewarn your majesty that when my spirit shall present the royal shapes of Alexander and his paramour, your grace demand no question of the king, but in dumb silence let them come and go.
Oh, pietous Faustus, please,
We are content.
Aye, I am content too. And thou bring Alexander and his paramour before the emperor. I will be Actian and turn myself to a stag.
And I'll play Diana and bring you the horns pleasantly.
These are but shadows, not substantial.
Oh, pardon me. My thoughts are so ravished with the sight of this renowned emperor that in mine arms I would have compassed him. But Faustus, since I may not speak to them, to satisfy my longing thoughts of full, let me this tell thee. I have heard it said that this fair lady, whilst she lived on earth, had on her neck a little wart or mole. How may I prove that saying to be true?
Your Majesty may boldly go and see.
Faustus, I see it plain, and in this sight thou better pleasest me than had I gained another monarchy.
Away, be gone. See, my lord, what strange beast is gone and thrust his head out at window.
Oh, wondrous sight! See, Duke of Saxony, two spreading horns most strangely fastened upon the head of young Benvolio.
What, is he asleep or dead?
He sleeps, my lord, but dreams not of his horns.
Sport is excellent. We'll call and wake him. What ho, Benvolio!
Plague upon you, let me sleep a while.
I plead thee not to sleep much, having such a head of thine own.
Look up, Benvolio! 'Tis the emperor calls!
The emperor where? Oh, my head.
Nay, and thy horns hold. 'Tis no matter for thy head, for that's armed sufficiently.
Why, how now, sir knight? What, hang by the horns? This is most horrible! Fie, pulling your head for shame! Let not the whole world wonder at you!
Zounds, doctor, this is your villainy!
No, say not so, sir! The doctor has no skill, no art, no cunning to present these lords or bring before this royal emperor the mighty monarch, warlike Alexander. If Faustus do it, you are straight resolved in bold Actian shape to turn a stag. And therefore, my good lord, so please your majesty, I'll raise a kennel of hounds, shall hunt him so that all his footmanship will scarce prevail to save his carcass from their bloody fangs. Ho, Bellamar! Argeron!
He'll raise a kennel of devils, I think, anon. Good, my lord, entreat from here. I shall never be able to endure these torments.
There's good master, doctor. Let me entreat you to remove his horns. He has done penance now, sufficiently.
My gracious lord, not so much for injury done to me as to delight your majesty with some mirth, hath Faustus justly requited this injurious knight, which being all I desired, I am content to remove his horns. Transform him, Mephistopheles, and hereafter, sir, look you speak well of scholars.
Speak well of ye! Blood! And scholars be such cuckold makers to slap honest men's heads or horns of this nature, I'll ne'er trust smooth faces nor small ruffs more. If I be not revenged for this, may I be a gaping oyster and drink nothing but seawater!
Come, Faustus, whilst the emperor lives, in reflection of thy high estate, thou shalt command the state of Germany and live beloved of mighty Carolus.
Nay, sweet Benvolio, let us sway thy thoughts from this attempt against the conjurer.
Away! You love me not to urge me thus. Shall I let slip so great an injury, when every servile groom jests at my wrongs, and in their rustic gambols proudly say, Benvolio's head was graced with horns today? May these eyelids never close, till with my sword I have that conjurer slain. Here may Benvolio die, but Faustus' death will quit his infamy. If you'll aid me in this endeavor, draw your weapons and be resolute. If not, depart!
Nay, we'll stay, and betide what may, and kill that conjurer if he comes this way.
Gentle Frederick, then hie you to the grove, and take our servants and our followers, and place them there close in an ambush. By this I know the conjurer is near. I saw him kneel, kiss the emperor's hand, and take his leave laden with rich rewards. Then, soldiers, boldly fight. If Faustus die, take you the wealth. Leave us the victory.
Soldiers, follow me to the grove. He that kills them shall have gold and endless love.
Yeah!
My head is lighter than it was by the horns, but my heart is more ponderous than my head and pants to see this conjurer dead.
Where shall we place ourselves then, Benvolio?
Here we will stay to bide the first assault. Though were that damned hellhound but in place, thou soon should see me quit my foul disgrace.
Close, close! The conjurer is at hand, and all alone in his gown comes walking. Be you ready to strike the peasant down.
Mine be that honor then. Come, sword, strike home. For horns he gave, I'll have his head anon.
Ooh, see, he comes!
No words! Now he will die. Hell take his soul. His body thus must fall!
Oh, groan you, Master Doctor!
Break may his heart with groaning. See, gentle Frederick, thus will I end his griefs immediately.
Strike with a willing hand! His head is off!
Ah, the devil now is dead! Now may the Furies laugh.
Was this that stern aspect, that awful frown, that made the grim monarch of infernal spirits tremble and quake at his dread command?
Was this that damned head whose art conspired Benvolio's shame before the emperor?
This is the head, and there the body lies, justly rewarded for his villainies.
Come, let us devise what more shame we may add to the hated... Nay, his hated name.
First, on his head, in quittance of my wrongs, I'll nail huge forked horns. And let us hang them in the window where he yoked me first, so that all the world may see my just revenge.
Well, what shall his beard do?
We shall sell it to a chimney sweeper. It shall outlast 10 birchen rooms, I warrant you.
What shall his eyes do, then?
We will pluck out his eyes, so that they may serve as buttons to his lips, so his tongue doesn't catch cold.
An excellent policy. Now, sirs, having thus divided him, what shall the body do?
Well, the devil's alive again! Have your head back.
Give him his head, for God's sake!
Nay, keep it.
For Faustus will have the
heads and hands, I all your hearts to recompense this deed. And knew you not, traitors, that I was limited for 24 years to breathe on earth?
And had you cut my body with your swords, or hewn this flesh and bones as small as sand, yet in a moment had my spirit returned, and I had breathed a man made free from harm. But wherefore do I dally my revenge? Belimor! Astaroth! Mephistopheles! Go horse these traitors on your fiery backs, and mount aloft with them as high as heaven, then pitch them to the lowest depth of hell. Yet stay. The world shall behold their misery, and after hell shall plague their treachery. Go, Belimor, take this cake of fence and hurl him in some lake of mud or storage. And this other, drag him through the woods among the pricking thorns and sharpest briars, while with my gentle Mephistopheles, this traitor flies unto some steepy rock, which rolling down shall break the villain's bones, as he intended to dismember me. Fly hence! Dispatch my charge immediately!
Yes, gentle Faustus, save our lives!
Away!
He must needs go in a devil drive!
What's this? An ambush to betray my life. Baseless! Stand! Below these trees, remove at my command, and stand as bulwarks twixt yourselves and me, to shield me from your treachery. But to encounter this your weak attempt, behold, an army comes incontinent.
Benvolio.
Oh, heavens defend me! Oh, shall I be tormented still?
Nay, fear not, men. We have no power to kill.
When transformed thus, your heads are all set with horns.
You have hit it right. It is your own, you mean. Feel on your head.
Horns again.
Nay, chafe not, men. We are all spent.
What devil attends this damn magician that spite our wrongs are doubled?
What may we do to hide our shames?
No, if we seek to seek our revenge, he'll just join long ass's ears to these huge horns of ours, make us laughing stocks to all the world.
What shall we do then, dear Benvolio?
I have a castle joining near these woods. Thither there we'll repair and live obscure, till time shall alter these our brutish shapes! Sith black disgrace that thus eclipsed our fame, we'd sooner die with grief than live with shame.
$40.
And friend, thou canst not buy so good a horse for so small a price. I have no great need to sell him. But if thou likest him for $10 more, take him, because I see thou hast a good mind toward him.
I beseech you, sir, accept of this. I am a very poor man, and have lost very much of late by horse flesh. This bargain would set me up again.
Well, I'll not stand with thee. Give me the money. Now, sirrah, I must tell thee. You may ride him over hedge or ditch and spare him not, but do you hear? In any case, ride him not into the water.
How, sir? Not into the water? Why, will he not drink of all water?
Yes, he will drink of all waters, but ride him not into the water, over hedge or ditch, or where thou wilt, but not into the water. Go bid the hostler deliver him unto thee, and remember what I say.
I warrant you, sir. Oh, joyful day! Now am I a made man forever!
What art thou, Faustus, but a man condemned to die? Thy fateful time draws to a final end. Despair doth drive distrust into my thoughts. Confound these passions with a quiet sleep. Tush! Christ did call the thief upon the cross. Then rest thou, Faustus, quiet in conceit.
Alas! Alas, Dr. Fustian, quoth the mass, Dr. Lupus was never such a doctor. He hath given me a purgation. He hath purged me of $40. I shall never see them more. But yet, like an ass as I was, I would not be ruled by him, for he bade me to ride him into no water. Now I, thinking my horse had some rare quality he would not have had me know of, I, like a venturous youth, rid him into the deep pond at the town's end. I was no sooner in the middle of the pond when my horse vanished away, and I sat straddling upon a bottle of hay, never so near drowning in my life. But I'll seek out my doctor and have my $40, or I'll make it the dearest horse. Oh, yonder is his snipper snapper. Do you hear? You, hey, pass.
Now, sir, what would you? You cannot speak with him.
But I will speak with him.
He is fast asleep. Come some other time.
I'll speak with him now, or I'll break his glass windows about his ears.
Well, I tell you, he has not slept these 8 nights.
And he not slept these 8 days. I shall speak with him.
See, where he is, fast asleep.
Aye, this is he. God save you, Master Doctor! Master Doctor! Master Doctor Fustian! $40! $40 for a bottle of hay!
You see, he hears you not.
So-ho! So-ho! Ho! What, will you not wake? I'll make you wake ere I go. Ah! Oh. Ah! Alas! I am undone! Oh. What shall I do? I am pulled off his leg!
Oh, help, help! The villain has murdered me!
Murderer, not murdered! Now he has but one leg! Run him and cast his leg into some ditch or another!
Stop him! Now Faustus has his leg again, and the horse courser a bundle of hay for his $40.
Why, oh, now, gardener, what's the news with you?
If it please you, sir, the Duke of Vanholt doth earnestly entreat your company, and hath sent some of his men to attend you with provision fit for your journey.
The Duke of Vanholt's an honorable gentleman, and one to whom I must be no stranger of my cunning. Come away!
Bring you to the best beer in Europe. What ho, hostess?
Where be these whores?
How now? What lack you? What, my own guest?
You are rough. Dost thou know why I stand so mute?
No, Robin. Why is it?
I am 18 pence on the score. But say nothing. See if she's forgotten me.
Who's this that stands so solemnly by himself?
Ratwell.
What? My own guest?
Oh, hostess, how do you? I hope my score stands still.
Ah, there's no doubt of that, for methinks you make no haste in wiping it out.
What? Hostess, I say, let's have some beer.
You shall come.
Look into the hall there.
Oh!
Come, sirs. What shall we do now till my hostess comes?
Mary, sirs, I'll tell you the brave.
bravest tale of our conjurer, serve me. Okay. You know Dr. Faustus?
I, a plague take him. Here's someone has cause to know him. Did he conjure thee too?
I'll tell you how he served me. I was going to Wittenberg t'other day with a load of hay. He met me and asked me what he should give me for as much hay as he could eat. Well, now I thinking a little would serve his turn, bade him take as much as he would for 3 farthings. So he presently gave me money and fell to eating. And as I am a cursing man, he never left eating till he eat all my load of hay.
Oh, monstrous! Eat a whole load of hay! Oh, yes, yes, that may be, for I've heard of one who eat a whole load of logs.
No, you shall hear how furiously he served me. I went to him yesterday to buy a horse of him, and he would by no means sell him under $40.
$40?
Now I, sir, thinking that this, knowing this horse could be one that would ride over hedge and ditch and never tire, I gave him his money. When I had my horse, Dr. Faustus bade me ride him night and day and spare him no time. But, quoth he, in any case, ride him not into the water. Now I, sir, thinking that this horse had some quality he would not have me know of, what did I but ride him into a great river? I was no sooner in the midst of the river when my horse vanished away and I sat straddling upon a bottle of hay.
Oh, brave doctor!
But you shall hear how bravely I served him for it. I went me home to his house, and there I found him asleep. I kept a hallooing and a whooping in his ears, but all could not wake him. I, seeing that, took hold of his leg, and never rested pulling until I had pulled me his leg quite off. And then, 'tis at home in my hostelry.
And has the doctor one leg now? That's excellent! For one of his devils turned me into the likeness of an ape's face.
Some more drink, hostess!
Bark, you, we'll go into another room and drink some more, and then we'll go seek out the doctor!
Thanks, Master Doctor, for these pleasant sights. Nor know I how sufficiently to recompense your great deserts in erecting that enchanted castle in the air, the sight whereof delighted me as nothing in the world could please me more.
I do think myself, my good lord, highly recompensed in that it pleases your grace to think but well of that which Faustus hath performed. But gracious lady, it may be that you have taken no pleasure in those sights. Therefore, I pray you, tell me the thing you most desire to have. Be it in the world, it shall be yours. I have heard that great-bellied women do long for things are rare and dainty.
'Tis true, Master Doctor. And since I find you so kind, I will make known unto you what my heart most desires to have. And were it now summer, as it is January, a dead time of the winter, I would wish for no better meat than a dish of ripe grapes.
Yeah, this is but a small matter. Let the bottles away. Madam, I shall do more than this for your content. Here now, taste you these. They should be good, for they come from a far country, I can tell you.
This amazes me more than all the rest, that at this time of year, when every tree is barren of his fruit, from whence you had these ripe grapes.
So please, your grace, the year is divided into 2 circles over the whole world, so that when it is winter with us, in the contrary circle, it is likewise summer with them, as in India, Saba, and such countries as lie far to the east, where they have fruit 2x a year. From whence, by means of a swift spirit that I had these grapes brought, as you see.
These be the best grapes I ever tasted in my life.
I'm glad they content you so, madam.
Come, madam, let us in, where you must well reward this learned man for the great kindness he hath showed to you.
And so I will, my lord. And whilst I live, rest my life, beholding for this courtesy.
I humbly thank your grace.
Come, Master Doctor, follow along and receive your reward.
The gate, go pacify their fury, set it open, then demand of them what they would have.
How now, masters? What a coil is there! What is the reason you disturb the doctor?
We have no reason for it! Therefore, a fit for it! Why?
Why, you saucy varlets, dare you be so bold?
I hope, sir, we have wit enough to be more bold than welcome!
Elsewhere, and trouble not the doctor.
What would they have?
They all cry out to speak with you.
Aye, and we will speak with him.
Will you, sir? Commit the rascals.
Commit with us. You are as best commit with his father as commit with us.
Now let them come in. They are fit subject for a mirth. Now, my good friends, Faith, you are too outrageous, but draw near. Welcome all.
Nay, we will be welcome for our money, and we will pay for what we take. Bring us a half dozen beers here, and be hanged!
Nay, hark, you, can you tell me where you are?
Aye, marry, can I? We are under heaven.
Aye, Sir Saucebox, but know you in what place?
Aye, the house is good enough to drink in. Zooms, fill us some beer, or we'll break all the barrels in the house and dash out your brains with your bottles.
Smoke home, be not so furious. You shall have beer.
Aye, there spake a doctor indeed. And Faith, I'll drink a health to thy wooden leg for that work.
To my wooden leg? What dost thou mean by that?
Oh, dost hear him, Dick. He has forgot his leg.
Aye, does not stand much upon that.
No, Faith, not much upon a wooden leg.
Good Lord, that flesh and blood should be so frail with your worship. Do not you remember a horse, courser? You sold a horse to?
Yes, I remember I sold one a horse.
Do you remember you bid he should not ride him into the water?
Yes, I very well remember that.
Do you remember nothing of your leg?
No, in good sooth.
I pray you remember your courtesy.
I thank you, sir.
Well, 'tis not so much worth. I pray you tell me one thing.
What's that?
Be both your legs bedfellows together every night?
Would you make a colossus of me that thou askest me such questions?
No, truly, sir, I would make nothing of you, but I would fain know that.
Then I assure thee certainly they are.
I thank you, I am fully satisfied.
But wherefore dost thou ask?
Oh, for nothing, sir, but methinks you should have a wooden bedfellow of one of them.
Sir, do you hear? Did I not pull off one of your legs while you were asleep?
Yes, but now I am awake, I have it again. Look you here, sir.
Oh, horrible!
Have the doctor three legs?
Do you remember, sir, how you cozened me and eat up my...
Do you remember how you made me wear an ape's face?
You poor son, conjuring scab. Do you remember how you cozened me?
Have you forgotten me, sir? You think to cast it away with your hay pass and your repass, and you forgot the dog pit?
Who shall pay me for my ill? Are you master doctor? If you send away all my debts, who shall pay me for my...
I think my master means to die shortly. He has made his will and given me his wealth, his house, his goods, his store of gold and plate, besides 2,000 ducats ready coined. I wonder what he means. If death were nigh, he would not frolic so. He's at supper now with the scholars, where there's such belly cheer as Wagner in his life hath never seen the like. But see where they come, belike the feast has ended.
Master Dr. Faustus, since our conference about fair ladies, which is the beautifulest in all the world, we have determined with ourselves that Helen of Greece is the admirablest lady that ever lived. Therefore, Master Doctor, if you would do us so much the favor to let us see this peerless dame of Greece, whom all the world admires for majesty, we would be much beholden unto you.
Gentlemen,
for that I know your friendship is unfeigned, it is not Faustus' custom to deny the just requests of those that wish him well. You shall behold that peerless dame of Greece, not otherwise for pomp and majesty, than when Sir Paris crossed the sea with her and brought the spoils to rich Dardania. Be silent then, for danger is in words.
Was this fair Helen, whose admired worth made Greece with 10 years of war afflicts poor Troy?
Too simple is my wit to tell her worth, whom all the world admires for majesty.
Now we have seen the pride of nature's work. We'll take our leaves, and for this blessed sight, happy and blessed be Faustus evermore.
Gentlemen, farewell. The same I wish to you.
Oh, gentle Faustus, leave this damned art, this magic, that will charm thy soul to hell and quite bereave thee of salvation. Though thou hast now offended like a man, do not persever in it like a devil. Yet thou hast an amiable soul, if sin by custom grow not into nature. Then, Faustus, will repentance come too late. Then thou art banished from the sight of heaven. No mortal can express the pains of hell. It may be this my exhortation seems harsh and all unpleasant. Let it not. For, gentle son, I speak it not in wrath or envy of thee, but in tender love and pity for thy future misery. And so have hope that this my kind rebuke, checking thy body, may amend thy soul.
Where art thou, Faustus? Wretch, what hast thou done? Hell claims his own, and with a roaring voice says, Faustus, come, thine hour is almost come. And Faustus now will come to do the right.
Oh, stay, good Faustus, stay thy desperate step. I see an angel hover o'er thy head, and with a vial full of precious grace, offers to pour the same into thy soul. Then call for mercy and avoid despair.
Good friend, I hear thy words to comfort my distressed soul. Leave me a while to ponder on my sins.
Faustus, I leave thee, with grief of heart, fearing the enemy of thy hapless soul.
Cursed Faustus, wretch! What hast thou done? I do repent, and yet I do despair. Hell strives with grace for conquest in my breast. What shall I do to shun the snares of death?
Thou traitor, Faustus! I arrest thy soul for disobedience to my sovereign lord. Revolt, or I shall in piecemeal rend thy flesh.
I do repent that ere I offended him. Sweet Mephistopheles, entreat thy lord to pardon my unjust presumption. And with my blood I will again confirm the former oath I made to Lucifer.
Do so with unfeigned heart, lest greater dangers do attend thy drift.
Torment, sweet friend, that base and aged man that durst dissuade me from thy Lucifer with greatest torments that our hell affords.
His fate is great. I cannot touch his soul, but what I can afflict his body with, I shall attempt, though it be but little worth.
One thing, good servant, let me crave of thee, that I may glut the longing of my heart's desire, that I may have unto my paramour that heavenly Helen that I saw of late, whose sweet embraces may extinguish clean those thoughts that do dissuade me from my vow and keep the oath I made to Lucifer.
That or all else thy heart desires shall be had in twinkling of an eye.
Is this the face that launched 1,000 ships and burnt the topless towers of Ilium? Sweet Helen, make me immortal with a kiss. Her lips suck forth my soul, see where it flies. Come, Helen, come, give me my soul again. Here will I dwell, for heaven is in these lips, and all is dross that is not Helena. I will be Paris, and for love of thee, instead of Troy, shall Wittenberg be sacked. And I will combat with weak Menelaus, and wear thy colors in my plumed crest. Yea, I will wound Achilles in the heel, and then return to Helen for a kiss. Oh, thou art fairer than the evening air, clad in the beauty of 1,000 stars. Brighter art thou than flaming Jupiter when he appeared to hapless Semele. More lovely than the monarch of the sky in wanton Arethusa's azured arm. And none but thou shall be my paramour.
Thus from infernal Dis do we ascend to view the subjects of our monarchy, those souls which sin seals the black sons of hell, among which, as chief, Faustus, we come for thee, bringing with us everlasting pain and torment and damnation, to wait upon thy soul. The time is come which makes it forfeit.
This gloomy night here, in this room, must wretched Faustus be.
Then here we'll stay, to mark him how he doth demean himself.
Oh, how should he but in desperate lunacy? Fond worldling, now his heart's blood dries with grief, his conscience kills it. Now his idle brain begets a world of laboring fantasies to o'ermatch the devil, but all in vain. His store of pleasures must be sauced with pain. He and his servant Wagner are at hand, come from both filling out his latest will. See, will they come?
Say, Wagner, thou hast perused my will. How dost thou like it?
Sir, so wondrous well, as in all humble duty, I do yield my life and lasting service for your love.
Good mercy, Wagner.
You're welcome, gentlemen.
Now, worthy Faustus, methinks your looks are changed.
Oh, gentlemen.
What ails Faustus?
Oh, my sweet chamber fellow, had I lived with thee, then had I lived still. But now must die eternally. Oh, look, sir. Oh, comes he not? Comes he not?
My dear Faustus, what imports such fear?
Is all our pleasure turned to melancholy?
He's not well with being over solitary.
If it be so, we'll have physicians, and Faustus shall be cured.
But a serpent, sir, fear nothing.
A serpent of deadly sin that hath damned both body and soul.
Faustus, look up to heaven and remember mercy is infinite.
But Faustus's offense can ne'er be pardoned. The serpent that tempted Eve may be saved, but not Faustus. Oh, gentlemen, hear me with patience and tremble not at my speeches. Though my heart pant and quiver to remember that I have been a student here these 30 years, yet, oh, when I had never seen Wittenberg, never read book! And what marvels I have done, all Germany can witness, yea, all the world, for which Faustus hath lost both Germany and the world, yea, heaven itself, heaven, the seat of God, the throne of the blessed, the kingdom of joy, and must remain
in hell. Forever, oh, hell. Hell, forever, sweet friends. What shall become of Faustus, being in hell forever?
Faustus, call on God.
On God, whom Faustus hath abjured. On God, whom Faustus hath blasphemed. Oh, my God, I could weep, but the devil draws in my tears. Gush forth blood instead of tears, yea, life. And so, cold, he stays my tongue. See, I would lift up my hands, but they hold them. They hold them.
Who bows it?
Why, Lucifer and Mephistopheles. Oh, gentlemen, I gave them my soul for my cunning.
God forbid.
God forbade it indeed, but Faustus hath done it. For the vain pleasure of 24 years hath Faustus lost eternal joy and felicity. I writ them a bill with my own blood. The date is expired. The time is now.
Why?
And he will fetch me.
But why did not Faustus tell us of this sooner, that divines might have prayed for thee?
Oft have I thought to have done so, but the devil threatened to tear me in pieces if I named God to fetch me body and soul if once I gave ear to divinity. Now, 'tis too late. Gentlemen, away, lest you perish with me.
Oh, what may we do to save Faustus?
Speak not of me, but save yourselves and depart.
God will strengthen me. I will stay with Faustus. Tempt not God, sweet friend, but let us unto the next room, that we may pray for him.
Aye, pray for me, but whatsoever noise you hear, come not unto me, for nothing can rescue me.
Pray thou, and we will pray that God may have mercy upon thee.
Now, gentlemen, farewell. If I live till morning, I'll visit you. If not, Faustus is gone to hell.
Faustus, farewell.
Now, Faustus, now thou hast no hope of heaven, therefore despair. Think thou on hell. That must be thy mansion there to dwell.
Thou bewitching fiend, 'tis thy temptation hath robbed me of eternal happiness.
I do confess it, and rejoice. 'Twas I, when thou wert on thy way to heaven, did dam up thy progress. When thou reached for the scriptures to peruse them, it was I who turned the leaves and led thy eye. Wherefore weep'st thou? Despair, 'tis too late. Farewell. Fools that laugh on earth must weep in hell.
Oh, Faustus, if thou hast given ear to me, innumerable joys had followed thee. But thou didst love the world.
Gave ear to me, Faustus. Now must taste hell pains perpetually.
Oh, what will all thy riches, pleasures, pomps avail thee now?
Nothing but to vex thee more, to want on earth ahead in hell such store.
Oh, thou hast lost celestial happiness, pleasures unspeakable, bliss without end. Hast thou affected sweet divinity? Hell or the devil had no power on thee. Hast thou kept on that way, Faustus? Behold, in what resplendent glory thou hast sit. In yonder throne, like those bright shining saints, and triumphed over hell. That thou hast lost. And now, poor soul, must thy good angel leave thee. the jaws of hell are open to receive you.
Now, Faustus, let thine eyes with horror stare into the vast, perpetual torture house. The Furies toss damned souls on burning forks. Their bodies boil in lead. Oh, there are ever-living coils that burn on the coals and ne'er can die. This air-burning chair is for our tortured souls to rest themselves in. And they're fed with soft, of flaming fire with a glutton, loving only delicacies, and laugh to see the poor starve at their gates. These are nothing. Thou shalt with thine eyes see 10,000 tortures that more horrid be.
No, I've seen enough to torture me.
Nay! Thou must feel them, taste the smart of all. He who loves pleasure must for pleasure fall. And so I leave you, Faustus, until anon, and then will thou tumble in confusion?
Oh, Faustus, now hast thou but one bare hour to live, and then thou must be damned perpetually. Stand still, you ever-moving spheres of heaven, that time may cease and midnight never come. Nature's eye, rise again and make perpetual day. Or let this hour be but a year, a month, a week, a natural day, that Faustus may repent and save his soul. O lente, lente, curiti, noctis equi. The stars move still. Time runs. The clock will strike. The devil will come. And Faustus must be damned. Oh, I'll leap up to heaven. See where Christ's blood streams in the firmament. One drop of blood will save me. Oh, my Christ. Ow. Rend not my heart for naming of my Christ, yet will I call on him. Spare me, Lucifer. Where is it now? It's gone. And see, a threatening arm, an angry brow, mountains and hills, come and fall on me and hide me from the heavy wrath of heaven. No, no. Then will I run headlong into the earth and gape. Not harbor me. You stars that reigned at my nativity, whose influence allotted death and hell, now draw up Faustus like a foggy mist into the entrails of yon laboring cloud, that when you vomit forth into the air, my limbs may issue from your smoky mouths, but let my soul mount and ascend to heaven. Past.
will soon be all past. Oh, if my soul must suffer for my sin, impose some end to my incessant pain. Let Faustus live in hell 1,000 years, 100,000, and at last be saved. No end is limited to damned souls. Why wert thou not a creature lacking soul? Why is that immortal that thou hast? Pythagoras, metempsychosis, were that true, this soul would fly from me, and I'd be changed into some brutish beast. All beasts are happy, for when they die, their souls are soon dissolved in elements, but mine must live still to be plagued in hell. Accursed be the parents that engendered me! No, Faustus, curse thyself. Curse Lucifer that hath deprived thee of the joys of heaven.
Such forward wits to practice more than heavenly power permits.